Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Awaking Wonder, Opening Your Child's Heart to the Beauty of Learning by Sally Clarkson, narrated by Sally Clarkson. I dedicate this book to Clay, Sarah, Joel, Nathan, and Joy, my worthy companions in a journey of wonder and inspiration. Who could have known how much fun, adventure, and sweet community would come from our years of exploring the world together? I dearly love you all. And to my wonderful God, who inspired us to awaken to a different way of living and to see His miracles and love at every turn. A letter to the listener. Long before you had this book, God was writing this story on the heart of a mother. Like you, she longed to raise her children to do more than simply survive this world we are living in. She wanted them to thrive. Her hope and prayer that each child would grow into someone who would bring light, goodness, and beauty to the world. And that's exactly what happened. You and I know the mother of those four children is Sally Clarkson, the beloved mentor to countless moms around the world. And now Sally is sharing the core philosophies that led her on the adventure of motherhood. This is Sally's story, written in its most complete form yet. You are in for a treat. When Sally came to us with the idea for Awaking Wonder, we at Bethany House Publishers offered our enthusiastic yes. We recognize the importance of this particular book for this particular time. In this fast-paced world, parents feel as if they are losing ground. Many are losing confidence. We hear from parents who want to raise children with healthy minds and a vibrant faith before launching them into the world. But they feel like they are doing it all wrong. Along comes Sally to encourage and guide. She reminds us that, as parents, we cannot depend on someone else to shape the destiny of our children. The responsibility is ours, given to us by God. Faith, knowledge, wisdom, and moral virtue must be taught, upheld, treasured, and embraced for a lifetime. It is our service to God to be stewards of our children's lives, Sally writes. But Sally also reminds us that we don't do this alone. God has equipped us for the task before us, and He walks with us each step of the way. Sally's philosophy of educating, centered around a wonder-filled life, awakened something in me as I edited. You see, long before I was an editor, God was writing a story in me too. I am a mom to two girls. From my early days of motherhood, I began to pray, "Lord, help me awaken the potential in these children. Guide me as I raise them to love you and serve you in a world that is ever-changing." As a trusted mentor, Sally has been an answer to that prayer. The principles and philosophies in this book are tested and timeless. They will help each of us as we guide our children toward rich intellectual and spiritual growth. Awaking Wonder is destined to become a classic as we raise up the next generation. My prayer is that this book will change the way you see the world, your child, and yourself as the chief steward of your children's lives. When I finished reading the last page of this book, I wrote these words to Sally. It was more of a privilege than a job to read Awaking Wonder, and I was thrilled that I got to be one of its first readers. You are a fine writer and thinker with a heart so full of the love of Jesus that it spills onto every page. Now, my friend, it's your turn. Awaken to the wonder. Jennifer Dukes Lee, Nonfiction Acquisitions Editor, Bethany House Publishers. Chapter 1. A Wonderful Beginning. Wonder is a noun, a feeling of amazement and admiration caused by something beautiful, remarkable, or unfamiliar. A desire to know something thoroughly. It's a verb to feel curious and to engage in imagination. We do not merely want to see beauty, though God knows even that is bounty enough. We want something else which can hardly be put into words, to be united with the beauty we see, to pass into it, to receive it into ourselves, to bathe in it, to become part of it. C.S. Lewis, The Weight of Glory. Memorable and momentous occasions rarely announce themselves ahead of time, but often tiptoe quietly into the corners of our lives and yet leave a profound influence. So this particular evening stands out to all of us as a sort of mysteriously sacred shared event that shaped a deep part of our souls. In the late evening, just after sunset, chill mountain breezes of summer night swirled around us, and I shivered involuntarily. Thousands of stars shone above like diamonds on a velvet cloak and beckoned us to stop, to enter into their reality. Tonight, we should sleep out under the stars, I thought. I had not seen such a cloudless, clear view of the night skies in a very long time. When I announced my plan, excitement burst forth through squeals, jumping up and down, smiles that lit up the room. Making plans and giving orders, I bustled about, dragging sleeping bags and pillows onto our deck. At 7,300 feet in elevation, our little rustic home was tucked away at the foot of towering Colorado Rockies, bordering 25,000 acres of national forest. We were surrounded by the long, dark shadows of the trees, waltzing to a mountain song, and the pine forest whistled as the breeze gently moved branches back and forth. We found ourselves invited to a dramatic performance by an infinite array of stars twinkling across our night sky. Here, away from the lights of the city, the whole world of sky sparkled with movement and flashes as though elegantly parading in the heavens, in sync with the pine trees. We considered that we had box seats and were audience to the angels rollicking, swirling in the light, moving to the rhythm of the swaying branches, just for our pleasure. Our magical night world was awash with mystery and whimsy. 4-year-old Joy plopped into my lap as I eased onto our old wooden bench. Her brothers Joel, 12, and Nathan, 10, ran wildly up and down our deck, yelling, punching, giggling, and pointing to a shooting star here and the Milky Way there. Clay, my husband, turned up the soft acoustic music from inside the house so that a symphony of haunting melodies accompanied this transcendent evening of delight. The night sky darkened and marked the time for us to cuddle for warmth in a pile under the sleeping bags. We all lay flat on the creaky deck, looking up into the showcase of myriad glimmering lights. In this auditorium of splendor, we all marveled. An almost sacred hush fell over us and gave calm and peace to our previously distracted souls. Sarah, at 15, was wrapped in a warm quilt. Hidden in a dark corner, she watched the beauty and the safe comfort of her private imaginations. All of us were wonderstruck at the infinite stars, the sky chandelier shimmering, the vastness of the celestial art above. A calm blanketed us in our delighted participation together as we breathed in the spectacular expanse so generously given us that never-to-be-forgotten night. As we submitted to the silence and reveled in the glorious moment, the marvel of its vastness seemed to quell any small worries or issues that had troubled us before, and we breathed release and felt peace. Each of us was caught up in our own mind castles, where feelings and thoughts danced through our wanderings, elegantly, freely, in celebration of the grace of our moments. The 6 of us were invisibly joined together as the threads of our hearts were woven through the unspoken sharing. As we sat in reverie of the grandeur, we were enveloped with a sense of an artist greater than us and with an awareness of being small but hidden in our Creator's magnificence. merely to be in the vastness of such a display of power and beauty all at once was to witness sublime reality beyond our comprehension. We were captured in the wonder of it all, together. No lecture was necessary, no command for everyone to pay attention or to look. Our stargazing, admiration, imagination, wondering, and dreaming was a natural response to the beauty we willingly entered. As Lewis wrote, we wanted to be united with the beauty we see, to pass into it, to receive it into ourselves, to bathe in it, to become a part of it. Wonder was already sown deeply into our psyches by the one who had made us. The drive to ponder, to imagine, to ask questions, to be curious, to ask how, why, to open our hearts, our hands, our souls, and to know was a part of our soul's delight. Quiet mountain shadows wrapped us in tender arms and rocked each of us in a lullaby. The stillness spoke peace. The night sky provided food for our imaginations, but each of us experienced personal, unique responses. Discoveries were already waiting to be unearthed. Each of us had a different response and diverse thoughts because we experienced the night with unique personalities at various ages and levels of maturity. Conformity of thinking didn't even enter my expectations. Instead, I wanted to orchestrate an evening when we would all be under the spell cast by a myriad of stars in the vast expanse of heavens. I hoped to awaken wonder and stir imagination as we were caught in the immediate invitation to participate. I trusted that our brains would engage without my artificial interference or interruption. How often we miss the fingerprints of the artist behind it all because the eyes of our heart are distracted or busy with more temporal demands, the noise of life beckoning us to follow. How different the fruit of a life given to create time for wondering, imagining, reflecting. But it must be sought intentionally. It must be fought for among the constant voices tempting us to the draw of busyness. The power behind a wonder-filled life. Wonder is the engine that drives curiosity and propels a robust intellect. Wonder gives us a lens through which we better view the miraculous, the sacred, the intricacy of our world around us, and helps form our spiritual imagination. We ponder the personality, inspiration, and breadth of the one who crafted all the sublime natural art that we behold. We respond in awe and worship. A child fashioned by a wonder-filled life will cultivate inner strength, a confidence in his own ability to think, to evaluate, and to know. But those who influence children must fight to protect time for the imagination to have space to work, to have time to engage. Recognizing the elegant and complex design of human beings, we understand that each has a capacity to think, to create, to acquire mental muscle, to love, having agency to act in life. Child development experts tell us foundations often determine long-term outcomes. To give a child the gift of time to imagine, to dream, to create, to engage, and to wonder is to allow time and space for his heart to be touched by the beauty surrounding him, for his mind to have room to grow strong on the feast laid out for his imagination, and for his emotions to bathe in the tranquility of a peaceful life in an unhurried rhythm. Then we offer a feast of theology, math, story, literature, virtue, faith, science, nature, art, music, and culture upon which to apply his wondering and wonderful mind. To lay this foundation is to give our children beauty and strength of imagination and the strong pleasure of learning and acquiring knowledge over a lifetime. Wonder is the catalyst in shaping a powerful, engaged intellect. Awaking Wonder is my memoir of sorts. This is my story my memories of how our vision for creating a wonder-filled life worked itself out in and through the lives of our four children, now adults, flourishing in their own lives of creativity, imagination, and wonder. We took a different path when it came to education in our family. Over the years, I've had many opportunities to discuss the foundational ideas most important to us with other educators, parents, and of course, our own children, who are the fruit of those efforts. We certainly employed lots of vision and ways of seeing children that guided the way we treated, nurtured, and mentored them. It is my desire that anyone who engages in the development of children will be inspired by the principles collected here. I invite all who care about the flourishing of children, about the ability to open infinite worlds of wonder, about sparking imagination, enthusiasm, and excitement for learning, to be encouraged by the legacy of our family shared in this book. A desire to give hope that children can be filled with delight, are able to store up goodness, and can live with confidence even in the midst of challenging times, is at the core of these messages. I hope this book will help teachers, parents, and anyone who works with children, and that our story might inspire and encourage parents and teachers to look at the children they influence with a new or renewed vision for how to give those children the best opportunity to flourish. I am not seeking so much to give a formula or offer specific advice, but rather to share the story of how, 36 years ago, my husband and I stepped out and took a risk on our belief that there was a way of raising our four children outside of the traditional 180 days of classroom education. Longing for our children to be free to grow deeply into their capacity for learning, to expand their creative, intellectual, and spiritual potential, and their excitement for diving into knowledge, we chose to educate them at home rather than sending them to a classroom. We desired that they could have space and time to access their full potential in heart, mind, soul, and body, and believed that this would be best done apart from a traditional school and the pathway of public education. Primarily, we wanted them to develop a passion and joy for learning and growing intellectually through the engine of wonder without the confines of comparison or competition with others. Perhaps you picked up this book to find inspiration for how to parent in such a way that your children will be inspired and your children attend public or private school. Keep listening. There are many ideas and principles here for shaping children in your home that are not limited by your choice of schooling. I think you'll find much encouragement in this book. Spiritual formation and cultivating a love for God and a personal relationship with Him were also central to our desire to pass on a wonder-filled life. Employing wonder in faith formation based on stories, words of truth, and tales of belief, and action stepping out into the extraordinary pathways of life filled our days. Ways to imagine the personal stories told in Scripture, and in response to love and to reach out to others amid the natural rhythms of the day, seemed a more authentic way to pass on heartfelt belief than indoctrinating our children solely with cognitive concepts of spiritual reality. Recognizing that each one is made for a relationship with their Creator, we fed their thoughts with Bible stories, theology, love, godly virtue, and character, and understanding to help shape a strong basis for spiritual development. We believed this faith would emerge from a longing in their own hearts to become a part of something bigger than themselves and to become one with their Maker. Our lives were unorthodox in our time, but we sought knowledge and learned that children raised in a wonder-filled environment could flourish in all areas of life and move into adulthood with a sense of well-being, a sense of purpose, a sense of centeredness, and a well of deep faith. Our story is about four very different children who grew up within the idealism of our philosophy and grew strong to flourish as adults. Respect for children and their potential strength paves the way to understanding how to engage their hidden internal motivation to become strong intellectually, spiritually, and emotionally. There are many principles shared that can be applied to different kinds of parenting and educational models. Innovative ways of inspiring children to love learning are being employed in many places and in a variety of ways. My main desire is to encourage, to come alongside, to inspire parents and teachers who are deeply committed to wanting to raise children with fully integrated hearts, minds, bodies, and souls. We called our educational model wholehearted learning. Our desire was to create a holistic life that considered how to cultivate able minds that could synthesize ideas, thoughts, and philosophy, to integrate wisdom into their lives, to cultivate warm, intimate relationships that would give emotional support and deep friendship, to give space to grow strong and vigorous bodies, to shape confidence and moral strength and character through a virtuous life, and to nurture a stable and satisfying spiritual faith. The goal of our wonder-filled learning method was to inspire a love for learning for a lifetime by igniting the spark within each child that is waiting to be lit with inspiration, imagination, and a sense of curiosity. Believing the real person is inside the heart, we sought to engage at heart level of inspiration, not only the mind level of cognition. When we approach the subject of learning, especially when it comes to children, we must understand that inside each of them is an endless desire to know, to understand, to ask questions, to engage, to study and gain knowledge, to dive fully into the waters of life. We can trust they already have a capacity and drive to learn, and our responsibility is to nurture and care for this capacity. We observe this even in babies, as in the first 3 years of life, a child learns to speak a foreign language with a vocabulary of at least 200 words and the ability to understand more than 1,000 spoken words. They learn to sit, crawl, walk, and understand nuances of emotional communication. Their brains can synthesize many complex transactions. And all of this without curriculums or formal lecturing or instruction. We are pre-wired to learn, to be interested in everything around us. I read many years ago that the average 4-year-old asks 100 questions a day, as mothers of 4-year-olds can attest, because learning and acquiring knowledge is a high motivation for a child. As a matter of fact, learning and accessing new knowledge is a pleasure to young children. Learning offers them a sense of healthy, autonomous self. For a young child to know something and to be able to share it is a sort of power, one they love to display. Pondering the whys of life and putting together abstract knowledge is enjoyable and even a hunger for most healthy children. It gives them a sense of accomplishment to learn how things work and to be able to operate more and more intelligently in their world. I remember a day more than 20 years ago when 4-year-old Joy, wearing the tattered and slightly stained pale pink ballet suit she donned each morning, ran across the 60-foot deck that bordered the length of our mountain home. Waving bubbles through a wand over and over again for more than an hour, she smiled confidently and said, "I am putting beauty back into the mountains like God did with the stars." If this sense of curiosity and wonder is inherent in a child, then we must believe it is also a fundamental part of our minds as adults. The ability to learn and to understand, to study, to know at every age is deeply satisfying. If we want to pass on a life of wonder, we must engage in the process ourselves. We were created to think and to wonder, to have time to engage in deep thoughts and profound ideas, and to have the pleasure of reading and acquiring new knowledge. To grow intellectually provides great satisfaction. In this, we were made to thrive. giving a gift of imagination and wonder to our children requires a certain way of living and a way of seeing our children as well as understanding our own design. It requires lots of time to feed on what is natural, away from the immediate gratification of technological devices. When we learn to honor the magnificent design of a child, acknowledging the capacity to access knowledge and ideas, and to have faith and to grow in virtue already inside of them, we give them an advantage in every area of life: relationships, cognition, creativity, character, faith, and more. We become the conductors of the symphony of their life, drawing out the music of imagination that is dormant. We do not have to tell our children how to think or what to think. They are made to learn and grow and access knowledge. What we need to do is to provide them with excellent food for thought, as well as superior resources, giving them personal attention, asking questions, letting them ask questions, and providing lots of interactive time. This is accomplished by supplying problems to solve, by engaging them in creative play, by filling their minds and hearts with imaginative stories that introduce them to a wide arena of their colorful world. We become their guides as we provide a smorgasbord of delightful food for their inspiration. Time to be bored so that they have to learn to fill their own hours well gives them a part in owning their capacity to create, design, and quantify through the tool of wonder. But to garner this important time, we must be careful not to over-entertain or distract our children with a schedule of constant activities and commitments. Wonder is the key. Wonder fuels learning, causes a brain to grow, exercises mental muscle, and gives a child impetus to grow intellectually. Wonder is focused on the child's power to engage and influence his own world by diving fully into what is drawing him to imagine bigger and broader concepts. Wonder teaches a child to own his capacity to know, to understand, to work, to generate interest in life. Just as wonder is a key for children, so it is for parents. There is no exact formula for parents or teachers to follow, but instead we recognize that each of us has agency to apply our imaginations and to give our imprint to education in the context of our own stories and priorities. Entering parenting unprepared. Many parents come into parenthood without vision, training, or understanding of how to unearth great potential in the lives of their children. They are unaware of or oblivious to how learning or brain development takes place. They are used to trusting that the system of education must be the best way to serve children simply because it is the way most people have been shaped in education year after year for more than a century, conforming to the ideals shaped by other authorities. This lack of training and vision causes us to be doubtful of our own untrained selves, fearing that we are not adequate or capable to invest in the process of our own children's learning. We might see education as a reductive process, composed of right answers, correct formulas, fill-in-the-blank norms of understanding knowledge. We believe there is only one way education happens because that is our own experience of learning. Soul-killing, mind-numbing, mobile, and teaching devices. Often smartphones and apps, computer games, and television are used to distract and passively occupy a child's time, training them to passively respond to a technological, machine-filled world without engaging the part of their brain responsible for the creation of new knowledge or unique thoughts and complex thinking skills. Children become addicted to these media devices by a process similar to drug addiction. The immediate gratification of such passive entertainment might seem like a reasonable babysitter for children, and that might be the case if the goal is to make our children easier to manage or to pacify them so we can do what we want to with our time. But this kind of mindless activity actually stunts part of the brain, and it kills the unseen impulse to create. A quick online search for effects of technology on child development will unearth endless articles regarding this problem. These passive ways of learning that don't engage the brain in developing mental muscle, so to speak, also destroy a part of the brain's ability to think abstractly or to synthesize and evaluate new ideas as well as concrete practical wisdom. When children's natural sense of wonder is spent on television, cartoons, and other media, those become the educational tools of inspiration that shape their intellect. When a child can remember dozens of movie and cartoon characters, but has never read a classic children's adventure, her brain has been shaped in an inferior direction. When the toys a child owns are all characters from movies, those toys will shape her values, effectively educating her. In some ways, we become like the sources of our wonder. Disney characters become children's heroes. Another method of education that has been employed is often ineffective in tapping into wonder. Lecture, a teacher standing in front of a class and speaking for a length of time, the method used in most classrooms as a way of passing on knowledge, is the least effective way for a child to understand a subject, causing her to lack retention of what she has heard. Only a small percentage of children are inclined to learn this way. Classroom lecturing is the way of education most parents experienced in their own schools, and so they accept it because it is familiar. Conversely, wonder, rather than classroom teaching, is a concept that has guided many intellects, inventors, and explorers throughout history. Plato wrote a conversation in an ancient manuscript in which Socrates says, "Wonder is the feeling of a philosopher, and philosophy begins in wonder." Thomas Aquinas wrote, "Wonder is a kind of desire for knowledge." G.K. Chesterton commented, "The world will never starve for want of wonders, but only for want of wonder." Einstein, C.S. Lewis, Goethe, Abraham Lincoln, Emerson, Shakespeare, Fyodor Dostoevsky, Lucy Maud Montgomery, Socrates, Thomas Edison, Lois Lowry, and so many more wrote extensively about the profound importance of wonder in the development of intellectual thinking, creating, and invention. Wonder was the basis for discovery and creativity that transformed our understanding of the world. Galileo, Copernicus, Sir Isaac Newton, Benjamin Franklin, Edison, Mother Teresa, and Marie Curie gathered their information and developed their philosophies and theories by wondering at the natural world, using their imagination to experiment, and pursuing knowledge considered outside the box of their contemporaries' understanding. Their courage to be different in the way they imagined and studied the world led to breakthrough knowledge that transformed life. Wonder was the tool through which Michelangelo imagined the fresco on the Sistine Chapel, the way Beethoven wrote his symphonies, the means by which Dickens wrote his novels. Wonder leads to imagination, where we connect dots to dots in complex thought processes. The more truth we gather, the more food for thought we are fed, the more concepts we understand, the more vigorous our intellect grows. Children given time to engage the gift of wonder feel free to imagine, to dream, and to pretend. This leads them to grow in knowledge as they find the relationship of all that is swirling in their minds to the world in which they live. They are free to take time to wonder and imagine and think. Opening your child's heart, mind, and soul to the beauty of learning. Each child has individual fingerprints, unique DNA, and a distinct personality accompanied by particular preferences and drives. When a parent learns to look deeply into her child's makeup and sympathizes with his unique design, she can develop the ability to open the child's heart, to engage his mind. As the major influences in their lives, we have the opportunity to narrate forward the story of possibilities for them by speaking of their gifts, their personality, their skills, and potential, while believing and verbalizing aloud the grand possibilities of who they are becoming. Our student collects ideas, philosophy, facts, and stories. These synthesize and become foundations of their own mental library of the world. A multitude of stories provides patterns of truth and wisdom that contribute to their own individual expression and understanding of how to live their life. Personal motivation comes from a heart that feels free to express, explore, question, and engage in life without the pressure of a need to conform or perform for an arbitrary standard or expectation. Parents who see beneath the surface to the heart, mind, and soul level of their children are able to listen for the fragile, innocent voice of the child's interests and drives in the direction in which they naturally long to grow strong. Inside each child is a reservoir of wonder waiting to be expressed and formed into mental strength. We accomplish this by shaping the way they are naturally made to grow, helping them fulfill their own destiny, so to speak. Inside of your child, an Einstein, Beethoven, or Bach might be waiting to emerge if given an environment in which to bloom and grow. When individuals are unconditionally accepted and set free to live into their own abilities, skills, and passions, they are more likely to be motivated to contribute from their own natural resources. Instead of being compared with others, each child can emerge with the confidence that who they are is of great value because they bear the unique imprint of their designer God on their lives. After risking raising our four children in a nonconformist lifestyle of education that valued each child's unique design, we saw vibrant adults emerge impassioned and motivated to make their own contributions to the world. Each one also emerged with an authentic faith in God, who is their Heavenly Father and Creator. To honor each person within the context of their own makeup gives a sense of value and dignity, as well as confidence. I hope that our story in this book will provide inspiration, encouragement, and practical ways to help cultivate an understanding of the power and influence of wonder, curiosity, and imagination in the formation of a child, a person. Imagine if all the parents everywhere turned their hearts to understanding that the shaping of children's hearts, minds, and souls was the best work they would ever accomplish in their lifetimes, regardless of whatever else they achieved. If personal time were valued above expedient living, if children could grow up in innocence and safety without the threat of sexual indoctrination and value-shaping dogma from secular public opinion in their classrooms, what would children become if they didn't have peer pressure, bullying, popularity, and conformity looming in their minds? How did our own night of wonder play out in our days? Just think, I had whispered in the moment of seeing a shooting star sprinting across the darkness of our night sky. Job tells us that when God created the world, the stars all sang. Can you imagine it? Stars singing? You can almost hear singing as you look up now into the night sky. And then in response, the angel shouted with joy, probably a lot like a crowd cheering enthusiastically at a ball game. It must have been quite the celebration. Sarah's soft voice emerged from her hiddenness. David wrote that the heavens are declaring the glory of God, she remembered out loud. Mama, quipped Joy innocently, I want to ask God what it was like when he painted the stars gold, silver, blue, and how he decided on these colors. I want to tell him I love what he made. And then she snuggled closer to me and sighed with a release of the adrenaline she had carried through her little girl day. I wish I could harness a shooting star and ride through the heavens, Nathan pronounced. My imagination, alive with thoughts and swirling, started working and the ideas popping into my own mind for the next morning. Light, space, infinitude of the stars, galaxies, constellations, let there be light. Joel suggested, I want to read about the stars tomorrow. I want to draw all of us lying here with the mountains and trees and Milky Way all around us, said Nathan, our relational prince. Over the next few days, we read a book about constellations, and Joel found a video online that showed the extent of our galaxy. Nathan borrowed a telescope from a friend. Researching the Milky Way, stars, and constellation filled hours of our days. We found a book that explained and displayed the major planets, the solar system, nebulas. At our dinner table, the older three spoke with excitement and reported what they had learned while Joy colored her own picture of the night sky. This idea led to that, and soon Galileo, Copernicus, gravity, orbiting black holes, and comets all became subjects of research. Nightly dinner table discussion from what Clay had found to read aloud combined with, Daddy, listen to what I learned today. We memorized Psalm 19, verses 1 through 6, and heartily agreed that the heavens were indeed declaring the glory of God. And we imagined David the shepherd crafting this song from his own perch on a desert mountain while guarding sheep. Sarah and Joel composed a little poem expressing their delight and thoughts about what had impressed them in these weeks we spent in the company of the heavens. Once again, as the summer came to an end, we returned to the beauty of our deck, the silence speaking to our hearts, and submitted to the breezes blowing, the sky dancing, and the sleep that eventually enveloped us all. Cultivating learning as a way of life. The whole world was our classroom. Each day there were new discoveries and engaging encounters as we encouraged observation of the parameters of their world. As a close band of humans walking through this discovery life together, over time we secured a deep love and connection for our small family community. Each belonged to the other and owed honor to one another as we mutually shared in discovery, adventure, and interest in life. Wonder and imagination as fuel to learning. Through engaging our children's imaginations by exposure to countless subjects, reading thousands of books, asking questions, encouraging curiosity, having them research subjects that came up along the way, we were able to cultivate ownership in a hunger and joy for learning, and a deep sense of faith sprinkled through the messages of each day. Engaging them in finding out facts, acquiring knowledge, and creating projects helped them to own their interests and live into their own mental prowess as an outworking of living in an unconfined life of exploration. Many people asked me over the years, well, just tell us which curriculum you used, which for science, literature, vocabulary, history, I want to buy the best age-graded curriculum. This question was unanswerable. Some desire a formula, a reductive, exact method of how to educate children. However, each family has its own puzzle of life. Each child has a different capacity, personality, and drive. Consequently, what we did would not work in exactly the same way for another family. Education is not about enacting a prescriptive, boxed sort of curriculum-based classroom, but instead is about passing on a legacy of a love for learning, an independent joy in discovery, a motivation to bring light, beauty, and goodness back into the world of our children. Time and space limit me from explaining what we did at every stage of life, though my husband Clay, with my input, has already written a 375-page book with many of the details of how we educated our children, called Educating the Wholehearted Child, which will point to the more detailed parts of our educational model. Here I am instead painting with broad brushstrokes to provide an overview of what shapes a learning, wonder-filled home. Consequently, this book is the skeleton, the basics of what is essential in creating a love for learning. It is looking back and remembering what I perceived was the most important to a wonder-filled home. It is a resource I hope will help you understand the foundations of nurturing children in a humane, authentic way that best prepares them to flourish in life. But mostly, it is the way we did it. It's an autobiography of our story of faith and risk. To separate from the busy, conformist, activity-driven lifestyle that can exhaust children and parents alike, and to move into a life of wonder requires a step of faith. Yet I hope that as I share our story, you might find permission and pleasure to apply at least some of these principles and find great joy in the wonder-filled life. Chapter 2, Committing to a Wonderful Life of Learning. Education is simply the soul of a society as it passes from one generation to another. Attributed to G.K. Chesterton. The direction you choose to walk determines the place you will arrive. The philosophy of education you embrace will determine the outcome and consequence of your students' value for learning. Sally Clarkson. Why a book on wonder, learning, education? Every child is a miracle, every single one. Each is born as a seedbed of potential for loving, thinking, creating, giving, working, and so much more. Yet they also come into the world fragile, vulnerable, and dependent upon those who would care for their needs and shape their foundations for life, their physical, emotional, and mental development, as well as their spiritual formation. In short, those who influence, love, and care for a child are shaping the destiny and possibilities of that child's whole life. Every parent is a teacher, every single one. They are the ones most closely connected to their child and who have the most personal emotional investment in seeing that their child grows healthy and strong. They have more weight in the long-term development of who their child becomes than anyone else who cares for their child. A parent's impact in teaching can be for the good or for the bad. It can shape an emotionally, intellectually, and spiritually healthy child, or leave a legacy of emotional, intellectual, and spiritual abuse and neglect, or provide a combination of both of these directions. Parents are profoundly influential in the lives of their children. Most parents deeply desire to leave a legacy of love and encouragement for their children, but sometimes they don't know how. Lack of training, pervasive secular cultural values, voices on the internet, and pressures from work often confuse and mislead them to the destructive path of an unhealthy relationship with their child. Emotional scars, lack of support and physical help, exhaustion, bad input, and lack of leadership have confused their decisions and created havoc in their relationship with their children. Children are totally dependent on their parents for the trajectory of their lives, regardless of the outside responsibilities that consume their parents' lives. The choices each parent makes about how they will influence their child might be determined by their prior commitments, their own upbringing, and the voices in their heads. Most often, the voice of the world invades the consciences of parents to communicate, "Let the experts do their job. They're trained to care for our children." Indeed, parents are the primary adults who will shape and form the way the child engages in life, relates to others, cultivates values and character, understands faith or lack thereof, and steps into the world in either a positive or negative way. The ways a parent influences and shapes the moments of a child's life lasts their whole lifetime. What to expect from this book? The journey of educating my children differently has probably been the most profound legacy of my whole life. Every parent has a different story, a different puzzle of life reflecting a variety of demands. Often parents must work many hours to be away from home, and the pressures of their responsibilities spread them thin indeed. However, the principles of opening...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.